Council. Welcome to this public meeting. We're here with Robin McAlpine from the Commonweal Project and the Jimmy Reid Foundation, and Dr. John O'Dowd, who's from Academics for Yes and works at the University of Glasgow. He did send me a CV, but it would take so long to read it out that I won't do that. Needless to say, he's a very distinguished academic from the University of Glasgow. What we're hoping the format will be tonight is that both of our speakers will do a short presentation, then we'll open the floor to questions. There are certain rules. These are people who are volunteering their time to speak, so any comments you would like to make, please keep polite. No swearing, because it annoys people, so don't do it.
That includes you.
And if we could keep our comments reasonable, that would be great. What we don't want to do is have lots of people cutting over each other and heckling. These people are, as I say, volunteers, and they are giving up their time tonight to do this. So if you can not cut over each other and not heckle, and I'm going to say the same thing to our two panellists as well, just to make the whole thing fair. So if I could start by asking Dr. O'Dowd to do his short presentation.
Thanks, Deborah. Well, it's actually a pleasure to be here in Kirkintilloch tonight. The furthest reaches of the Roman Empire, the cradle of the Industrial Revolution in Scotland, and the birthplace of this man, Tom Johnson, who wrote a wonderful book called Our Scots Noble Families. If you haven't read it already, read it. It's great. It tells you about how our betters came by their lands, how they got them, how they stole them off the people, how they kicked them off the land, how they murdered, how they slept with the right people, how they did all that. And in one case, the Kennedys of Cassillis slow roasted an abbot over a spit until he decided to sign over his land. And that's land that they've got right to this day. They own that because they roasted the abbot and got his land. Now, Tom Johnson wrote this 100 years ago, more than 100 years ago. He wrote it to show that the people that our nobility is not noble, that its lands are stolen. Lands stolen either by force or fraud. Show people that the title deeds are rapine, murder, massacre, cheating, or court harlotry. Dissolve the halo of divinity that surrounds the hereditary title. Let the people clearly understand that our present House of Lords is composed largely of descendants of successful pirates and rogues. Do these things and you will shatter the romance that keeps the nation numb and spellbound while the privileged pickets pockets. Nothing changes. And this is brought right up to date by Andy Whiteman's wonderful books, Who Owns Scotland? And the Poor Had No Lawyers. And you can read all about how nothing has changed in these years. The lands of Scotland were stolen by murder, by court whoring, rape, cheating, massacre, and the descendants of the folk that did that forged the Union and still sit in the House of Lords, the mother of parliaments, the UK government, the very same people that tell you today we're better together. Well, maybe that's okay for the Duke of Westminster, the biggest landowner in Britain, who holds vast tracts of Scotland, and whose son-in-law Dan Snow got all his pals to sign that lovely letter last week, the one asking us, please stay. The likes of Dr. David Starkey, asked us to stay. He wrote a couple of years back, or said on television actually, Scotland is a feeble little country, obsessed with the deeply boring provincial poet Burns and the awful bagpipes. Or also, Ross Kemp, that nice Rebecca Brooks's ex, who said, Glasgow is like a third world war zone. Or the Spectator's Rod Liddell, who 2010, that's a magazine, a Tory magazine, the only reason any people remain in Scotland is on account of the extremely cheap alcohol available in the supermarkets, plus a ready supply of heroin for when the alcohol runs out. Better together? Tom Johnson's other triumph was setting up the Scottish Hydroelectric Board. It was the first major green renewable energy system almost anywhere on the planet, certainly in this country, in this island. one of the first in the world. And it was built using money. It was built using Scottish money, Scottish sweat, and a few Scottish lives were cost in it. It was held under common ownership. It was a source of major benefit to all the people in Scotland. But now, Scottish Hydro, like everything else that was good and it was built by public subscription, has gone the way of all social enterprise in the neoliberal Thatcherite, Blairite, Brownite UK. It's owned now by Scottish Southern Energy, and it's now one of the worst offenders in ripping off the people, paying ridiculous charges, widespread fuel poverty, freezing homes, and the deaths of the old and the sick. That's what happens in Better Britain. We replace one set of robber barons with another bunch of robbing barons. Because, put quite simply, that's what it's all about. That's what it's always been about. And that's what it will continue to be about just as long as we let them get away with it. Getting rich, keeping rich, and damn the rest of you. And I've no doubt Prime Minister Boris will uphold that proud tradition. That's one set of traditions kept alive and well, kept alive and flourishing in Better Britain. That our Scots noble families, that parcel of rogues that threw their lot in with the Union in May 1707. It's been kept alive by Thatcher and Blair and Brun and Cameron and Boris. These latter-day noble people who know exactly who they're there to serve. But there are other better traditions, genuine Scottish traditions, traditions that emerge from the people of Scotland themselves, traditions that tell you something about the character and the soul of a people, what the people really like, what the ordinary people of Scotland hold valuable, what they think of themselves in the deepest wells of belief. One of these is education, and that's what I'm going to talk about tonight mainly, especially higher education, the universities, and what that means to the people in Scotland, and what it tells you about ourselves. But before I do that, I'd like to get one or two things out of the way. Education, as you may have seen in the blogosphere and the newspapers, has its own Project Fear. Obviously, Scotland is too wee, too poor, and too stupid to do without the UK's subsidies, and our universities will all fall down if we gain independence. They usually miss out the too stupid bit because even they are not stupid enough to say that, given what Scotland's universities, world-class universities, are like. Scotland does have some of the best universities in the world, some of the best scientists, engineers, and academics working in them. And like all such universities across the world, we have people from the entire planet working and studying in them. And that's great. And they wouldn't come if we weren't as good as we know that they are. So they can't get us in too stupid, but they do try to get us in too wee and too poor. All your research funding will disappear. Snow off a dike if you become independent. Students won't come and your universities will die. So let's deal with that one right away. I wouldn't normally quote a Murdoch newspaper, but here's one, 3rd of May 2012, by the Wall Street Journal. Right? And I'm going to read this out. Quote, but the claim that a penurious Scotland is a subsidy junkie has already been proven a myth. New accounts of revenue and expenditure from Treasury data show Scotland regularly gives more than it receives from UK coffers. And it goes on to give a whole load of numbers. And it finishes, there is now little dispute that Scotland on its own can be a viable economy. Or the Financial Times. Another paper that you wouldn't mistake for the Socialist Worker. An independent Scotland could expect to start with a healthier finances than the rest of the UK. And even Cameron agrees with this, although Alex Salmond couldn't get Alistair Darling to admit it last week. So forget about arguments about currency. They're irrelevant because the fundamentals of the Scottish economy are sound because the people of Scotland can make it work. What has dragged, and that's without oil, what's dragged us down year after year are Westminster policies that do us no favours, close our industries, shackle our inventiveness, steal our young people, and support a big casino and the City of London at the expense of everyone else. Do we? Well, tell that way, that one to Norway, Finland, Switzerland, Sweden, Denmark, and a number of other very successful small companies, countries. The Project Fear plays on an underlying insecurities that we have in Scotland that affect a population that was cleared off the land to make way for sheep, that's been used as factory and cannon fodder when it suited the ruling class, and then was ditched when it was decided that things could be made cheaper elsewhere. And despite that, we've survived and will continue to survive. And one of the main reasons that we've done so is the Scottish belief in education. Education for its own sake. Education for self-fulfillment. Education as a common good. Education as a source of wealth, real wealth, the common weal of Scotland. Education to create and enjoy culture. Education as a democratic tool. Education, Scottish education, is the firm base upon which everything else was built and which will drive our success after independence. There are lots of myths being peddled just now, but the idea of the Scottish democratic intellect founded upon the fruits of the Scottish Enlightenment are no myth. The fact that the term Scottish democratic intellect was used by a Tory, it was first used by a Tory, Walter Elliot, who, like Tom Johnson, became Secretary of State for Scotland. But unlike present-day Tories, Elliot had a solid cultural understanding of Scotland and the Scots. And so when George Davey published his book, Democratic Intellect, in 1961, it crystallised the attitude of mind that Scotland has about how we think of ourselves and how we are in relation to knowledge, to education, and the uses we put these to. The democratic intellect was principally about the character of Scottish society, Scottish sentiments, and Scottish intellectualism, and how these operate in each other, and then how these created the country's political and social systems, which in turn fed back into its character and sentiments. It was about the democratic and cultural bases that an engaged mind could operate on. A major part was also concerned with the changes to Scottish higher education that followed the Act of Union. Davey argued that these attempts to change the character of the Scottish universities therefore were trying to change the character of Scotland itself. Davey was right then, and it's worse now, because the UK is currently destroying our universities in the interests of profit, just as in England it is dismantling the NHS. These are all part of the same process. Despite that, Arthur Herman, an American historian, has described the Scottish Enlightenment as how Scots invented the modern world. But it also created an educational inheritance that gave Scots a clear idea of the role and social and moral purpose of education. The role and social and moral purpose of education. That's a very unusual thing to hear these days. Education has a social and moral purpose. Scottish education for a social and moral purpose. Compare that, for instance, to the sterile buffoonery that the current output of the UK Department Business and Innovation of Skills says. Yes, universities are actually now run, even the research part, Scottish universities are dictated to by the Department for Business. And in Scotland that happens too. They published a white paper in 2009, and this told us what the purpose of universities was. It wasn't moral purpose, or it wasn't social purpose. It was to make a bigger contribution to economic recovery and the future growth to be central to the country's economic performance in the 21st century. Translated, the purpose of universities in the UK is to better contribute to the wealth of those who already have wealth. And that's it. Where's the social and moral purpose in that? This is called the impact agenda, and if you've never heard of it, it's important, because it's happening now, and it's happening in Scottish universities, and it's poisoning research and intellectual inquiry right through the US. right through the UK and the US too. So when Davy was worried about transforming universities, he wasn't wrong. He understood the history and purpose of Scottish universities, and he knew that from the Middle Ages onwards, Scotland, with its tiny population, had five universities, when England and Wales had barely two, Oxford and Cambridge, mainly concerned with ecclesiastical matters. Meanwhile, in Scotland, Scottish Enlightenment, we had medicine, science, engineering, and God help us, even economics, much earlier than in England and Wales. We also had the likes of Anderson's College. Glasgow had two medical schools. Edinburgh had the most famous medical school in the world, and it made major advances. The Scottish Industrial Revolution was built on this education that people got in these universities. And all that happened in Scotland, and it's continued to happen until our industry was destroyed by the Tories. And they did that for a reason.
I apologise about that. I'm not sure who the heavy breather is, but we'll sort it out.
They wanted to kill a tradition, and that was that the Scottish universities existed to train people for work, first having provided them with an all-round education. And it largely gave Scotland its democratic character and its inherent distrust of power hierarchies. And that could be something to do with the treatment meted out to Scots by their betters in those Scots noble families. Davy talked about Scotland having stuck to a policy of apartness and social ethics that continued to rest upon the distinctive life of the country. And the Scottish universities carried through this through with a strong teaching tradition. They understood that in a poor country as it then was, you could only teach a minority of the people to educate at university level. So they therefore concentrated on the output of supremely well-educated teachers. School teaching has always been a graduate profession in Scotland, and graduates went out from the universities and taught in the schools. School in every parish, a graduate in every school. So the most important contribution by far of the Scottish universities has been in the quality of teachers that it has always produced, and the teaching they carry out and continue to carry out. But there's another very important part of what they did, most important in terms of our political culture, and that was that through the university themselves and the teachers they produced an educated citizenry that could challenge its betters and make democracy work. And this naturally makes the Scottish approach deeply unattractive to the neoliberal concept of economic freedom and the unhindered pursuit of profit. And that's what explains the unrelenting attack on education and the Scottish standards of that approach. So we get letters to the Herald, and we get things in the blogs that say Project Fear about Scottish universities. They write this kind of drivel. Scottish institutions have done extremely well when competing for UK Research Council grants. For example, in 2012-13, they won 13.1% of the funding available. A remarkable achievement for a country with just 8.4% of the UK population. Or they write something like, if Scotland were to withdraw from the UK and create its own research council, our research community would be denied its present ability to win proportionately more grant funding than the country contributes to the common research pool. Or this, after independence, it threatens the future of medical research in Scotland's world-class universities. This is all nonsense. It's rubbish, but its function is to frighten, not to inform or enlighten. The people who write such rubbish know nothing about the people of this country and its educational inheritance. So let's get this clear. The reason Scotland's world-class universities and medical schools do so well in research is because they are world-class, and they will stay world-class after independence. In fact, they'll be even better after the dead hand of Whitehall is removed from their shoulders. don't take my word for it. Here's Rick Rylance of Research Councils UK. Quotes, grants are awarded on the basis of open competition and decided through peer review by appropriate expert researchers on a project-specific basis. They are thus not allocated on the basis of location, either geographical or political. The distribution that arises does so naturally as a function of quality. By and large, research organisations located in Scotland achieve success at a rate and to an extent that is above what one might notionally think of as an even distribution across the UK. This recognises the distinctive excellence of Scottish research. That's what the UK, a UK government body, is saying, the chief executive of. So do these people who write such drivel really think that an independent Scotland is going to break a 500-year tradition and stop funding our universities? As with the NHS, the biggest threat to Scottish universities is remaining in the UK. And if you want to hear about the NHS, go and watch Dr. Philippa Whiteford on YouTube. And I've got YouTube down here, that just shows you how tech savvy I am. It's YouTube to me. Go and watch her, because she'll tell you very calmly and quietly what they're doing to dismantle the NHS in England and what they'll do in Scotland if we vote no. Because the funding of the NHS in Scotland is dependent through the Barnett formula and other things on the funding of the NHS in England. And if they cut public spending to it, as they will do, as they privatise it, then that will inevitably result in a cut in funding to our NHS. The Scottish education system is almost fully independent already, but it does rely to some extent on the Exchequer, the UK Exchequer for research grants. As English education moves increasingly towards funding from tuition fees rather than government spending, this will reduce the Scottish block grant as a result of the Barnett formula, putting more pressure on the Scottish government to reintroduce fees. So the biggest danger to Scottish university education is not independence, it's remaining within the UK. In any case, only 24% of research funding comes from the research councils. And the government has dropped this, the Tory government, Tory Lib Dem government, has dropped this by 20% in any case since the coalition got in. That's the record of Better Together Britain. Since the coalition came to power, the Campaign for Science and Engineering has noticed the cumulative erosion of the science budget is over 1.1 billion. And their director, Dr. Sarah Main, says the last 4 years of flat cash science budget is biting scientists and engineers and squeezing universities. They also note that the proportion of GDP spent on research and development in the UK languishes below the bottom of G8 and well below the EU 28 average. The reason is straightforward. The reason why Scotland continues to hold its own and more in the research is because in Scotland, education is valued for its own sake, and as a consequence, it has always claimed higher esteem and a share of national resources than anywhere else in these islands. And it's because of scholarly and educational values, not in spite of them, that useful knowledge drove the Scottish economy. And that this was in turn driven by disinterested curiosity. It's disinterested curiosity that drives research, and that's the parent of discovery. They tell us we'll lose our preeminence in medical research if we become independent. Nonsense. They tell us this will affect our health. Well, we do have great medical needs in Scotland. We have well-known health problems. But by and large, we don't need medical research to tell us what they are and how to cure them. Most are caused by the profound inequalities generated by the present economic and social system. It's not medical research that will tackle these problems. It's the removal of the social and economic inequalities that are the root cause. And we don't need any amount of research to tell us how to solve that. We need a different political and economic system. And I don't see how any of that is going to come from a bunch of political hoodlums that are the product of Eton and Oxbridge, or their friends in the city, or the landowners. I've recently had more information about cuts in Scotland, and what it's saying is that there's more efficiency cuts coming. Over 400 million more in the current spending round. This is from Graham Rake of RCUK, and it's made and he said, however, the research councils will need to demonstrate continued efficiencies in both terms of cash and as well as evidence of cultural change. Now note that phrase, in terms of cash and evidence of cultural change. Decoded, this means that the already brutal real terms cuts to the UK science funding budget are to be accelerated for the present funding year. And whilst that's bad enough, that will depend on evidence of cultural change. The very sinister meaning of this is that the price to be paid for a not too brutal settlement in terms of cuts to higher education funding is the imposition on us of a privatisation agenda. It's coming our way. It's happening in England. It will happen here. Commodifying science and determining its value to society in terms of the narrow estimation for its potential for economic impact. It's worth noting that if this nonsense had been working in the 1960s, Peter Higgs, the Nobel laureate for physics who worked in Edinburgh, would never have got funded to think about his bosons. And in fact, he might have been in trouble for not bringing in enough research funding, because we see people who are getting hammered in the universities because they're daring just to spend their time thinking like Peter Higgs did, and they're not bringing in enough dosh. That's the reality of Better Together. It's totally alien to the democratic intellect, and it's part of a process that is already destroying our universities. One last word on these bloggers. A common feature of these people is that they're all part of the UK unionist establishment. They sit in fancy committees, they get invited to Whitehall, and they meet their old chums, mainly from Oxbridge, and pick up their OBEs and knighthoods. Few of them has a clue about Scotland or Scottish education or the Scottish people even. So, the greatest danger to Scottish higher education is if we remain in the UK. The best hope for it and for the community values that lie at the heart of Scottish education and social ethics and morality is independence. And the same is true for everything else we hold dear in Scotland. England is moving rapidly to the right. It's dismantling the entire post-war settlement. Schools are getting privatised, hospitals, housing has already gone, welfare provision, universities are the least of it. Soon it'll all be gone. So the choice is not between independence and the status quo, it's between independence and the destruction of all social provision and endeavour. So if you vote no next month, you'll actually be voting yes. You'll be voting yes to university fees and the privatisation of higher education. You'll be voting yes to the privatisation of the NHS. Yes to weapons of mass destruction on Scottish soil. Yes to Trident. Yes to the bedroom tax. Yes to sending young Scots to fight and die in illegal wars. Yes to a discredited and alien approach to how we do things in Scotland. Yes to the landowners and the noble lords that Tom Johnson called out over 100 years ago, right here in Kirkintilloch. I'm pleading with you today to say a real yes. Yes in a positive way. Yes to a forward-looking democratic Scotland where we get what we vote for and vote for what's in our best interest, in the best interest of the Scottish traditions and sentiments. Vote yes for a fair and just society in Scotland.
statement. Thank you very much to Dr. O'Dowd for his presentation. I'd like to ask Robin McAlpine now to do a brief presentation to you as well, and then what we will do is we will open the floor to questions. So if you've got any questions, keep them stocked, stick your hand up at the end, and I will allocate them to one or other of our panel members. Thanks.
Right, okay. If I talk too long, throw stuff at me and tell me stop, because there's only one thing I really want to talk about tonight. We've got a decision to make. It's a big decision. And the decision has been presented by a lot of mainstream media as being some sort of pick between two lots of politicians have been arguing. No, this is a fundamental choice. We are choosing the nature of the country in which we are going to live. So let's think about the kind of country in which we're living, the kind of country we want to live in. Now what I want to do is a little bit of simple economics. Don't leave, it'll be fun, I promise. Just a little explanation. Because one of the things that the other side tends to do is they say, oh, you know, the problems are that big and they're that complicated. Nobody really knows how you're going to do anything about them anyway. So it doesn't make any difference whether you vote yes or no. We're all stuck with it anyway. This is complete rubbish. We know what's wrong. We know why it's wrong. We know how to fix it. And we can fix it in Scotland. That's all I want to tell you. All I want to tell you today is that they would like, you know, they talk about Project Fear. It's not actually about Project Fear. It's not about fear. It's a funny thing, this, because I mean, I do political strategy, so I do for a job. And people think that fear is an emotion that stops you doing things, that makes you sit down and stay still. To which I say, what would happen if you saw a tiger? You know, you see the fear, you might run. It's not necessarily an emotion that makes you not want to do things. The emotion, the state of mind that stops you doing things is lack of confidence. Because it's as simple as this. Throughout history, people that did things had confidence. People who didn't have confidence didn't do things. What they're trying to do is break down our confidence, make us believe that we can't do this. And so all I want to do is quietly talk through what's wrong, why it's wrong, how we fix it. And it's all about wages. I cannot say this enough. All of our problems stem back to wages, and I'm going to explain this. What do you think is a decent wage? A wage that you can live on, feed your family, pay your bills, participate in society, end of the month, you're not panicking, you're not in fear, you're not relying on tax credits, you're not hiring a tax lawyer, a decent salary. I'd say maybe £35,000 to £35,000 a year, something like that. Right, well, everybody who's working in Scotland today, only one in five people earn between £25,000 and £35,000. Three out of five working Scots earn less than £25,000 a year. Half of them earn less than £21,000. If you earn £14,000 a year, you're still better off than 30% of the working population of Scotland, and the average annual salary, the money that goes into their pockets by the end of the year, of the poorest 10% of people in Scotland is £6,000 a year. Now, I'm going to give you a quick comparison. Now, it's not a direct comparison, you can ask me about it later on, but by comparison, Norway, average salary, £45,000. Average salary of the poorest 10% of people working in Norway, £25,000. Their poorest 10% earn the same as the average of our entire workforce. We have the second lowest paid economy of any advanced economy in the world. This is madness, given our wealth and given our position. We should not be there. And it's really important, this, because you know how we always talk about economic growth, GDP's growing again. Well, it's so important that we get clear in our heads what words mean, because they throw words out the telly at us like we don't understand what they mean. GDP growth makes owners richer. If you own the economy, rising GDP makes them richer. There is only one thing that makes ordinary people richer, and it's rising wages. If we have rising GDP and we don't have rising wages, not only is it not good for us, it's bad for us. We'd be better if it wasn't a rising economy. And what's happening today? The unemployment figures are out and unemployment's down. This is good, except the nature of what has replaced this unemployment is incredibly low pay employment. And so inflation is running at 1.8%. And salary rises are running at 0.6%. I don't know if anyone in here is a professor of mathematics, but I think that would tell you we're getting poorer. We are getting poorer now. Wages are not rising with the rising economic, some degree of economic growth that's coming back to this country. That causes our problems, it makes you poor. That's why we are where we are. Now, it's not just about you being poorer, because it is. One of the crazy things about inequality is you talk to people about inequality, you know we're the fourth most unequal country in the world. But people think that that means that, you know, the bottom 20% are doing badly. But it's not. Or maybe it's the bottom 30 or 40%. But it's not. If you earn £35,000, you are already at the 80th percentile. 80% of the population earn less than £35,000. And £35,000 isn't even the pivot point for inequality. If you look at where other economies, what it looks like when the pay of people is more equal, someone with £35,000 would be earning more than that. 80% plus of the population suffer because of inequality. It's not a tip in the middle, it's a ramp. And only people that benefit are right at the top. But it's more than just the wages in your pocket. Because we did something to try and show why wages are so important. We took the Scottish tax model, so you can get a computer model of the UK tax system. And what we did was nothing with the size of the economy. So we didn't say, let's imagine the economy is bigger. We just said, keep the economy as it is. We didn't touch any of the tax rates. So we didn't say, oh, look, put tax rates up in the richer. No, we kept everything the same. The only thing that we changed was the distribution of wages in the economy. So what we did was, we took the distribution of wages that we have in a kind of Scandinavian country. And we made our spread of wages look like that, with the same number of people in employment as that. And we ran the tax model again, and it generated £4 billion of additional tax revenue without touching tax rates. Now that doesn't even include the fact that we would save probably another £2 or 3 billion in working family tax credits. Because if people aren't skint, you don't need to give them tax credits. And you don't have to pay for all the costs of poverty, the cost of the NHS, the costs to Social Security, the costs of policing when you have areas of a country which have endemic poverty problems, all these kind of things. Those costs would go on as well. It's worth, I don't know, £7-8 billion to us simply to get a better spread of wages. So that's the deficit fixed twice over. Any other problems anyone wants to raise? No? Go home? Why? Why is this happening? Why is it that we have this crazy problem whereby a wage spread is so unequal that because people don't have money in their pockets, they can't pay tax? Because they can't pay tax, our tax base is too low, so we can't invest in public services and infrastructure. Why? Very straightforward. It is the UK economic model. If you look at almost any indicator of how the UK behaves, the things that it does, the way it manages its economy, you'll find the same thing over and over. There's only one philosophy, and that philosophy is whoever's the biggest must be the best. Put two people in a room, whoever comes out alive must be the best. The other one, with nothing to learn from them, say, hell, mend them. You do that once, and then you do it again, and you do it again, and you do it again, eventually we'll end up at the best society ever. Through a process of conflict, letting the biggest win. The problem is, rather than being a recipe for the great society, this is just a charter for cheats and bullies. In fact, it's a charter for psychopaths. Psychopaths are surprisingly good at winning contests, especially when you take the rules away, which is why it is that some of our corporations really do behave like psychopaths. They do incredibly dangerous things and damaging things. You look at the banks, you tell me those banks weren't acting like madmen, because they could. Because by acting like that, they can make themselves richer and richer. And because the rules were made so that the crazier that they act, the richer that they got, until the whole fantasy world fell in, because it isn't true. You do not get the best outcome by letting everybody engage in a war of all against all, where we're all trying to tear each other's eyes out. That is not how it works. In reality, this is a bastardized version of Darwinian evolution. This idea that it's the strongest, the best fighter who wins and who wins and who wins. It's complete garbage. Don't know if any of you saw the documentary, the Horizon documentary with cats. Now I've got a cat. Love fights the cat, although she's an absolute psychotic killing machine. Barn cats, man. 3 rabbits a day we get in our house at this time of the year. She's still a sweet pea. And you wonder, most of them. And you wonder what she does when she's no there. So this documentary was great. It tracked cats, it followed their behaviours. And one of the things that was really interesting was cats are always fighting, right? You've heard them, and all that kind of stuff. That's cats fighting. No, that's cats not fighting. Because the interesting thing about cats is they're incredibly effective killing machines. If two cats fight, the winner will be probably hurt so badly that the winner will die too. If cats fought all the time, there'd be no cats left. So what happened? Evolution picked the cats that knew how to avoid a fight. And that's the cats that we have. Evolution doesn't pick the biggest bully. Evolution picks those who are best able to work with others and can be most effective. Now, if you look at the economies that are effective, that's how they operate. That's how they work. They don't allow the biggest to bully everybody out of the rest of the economy and let them capture all the money. They allow an economy which gives the maximum number of people and enterprises the maximum ability to try and compete. Now, I'll give you a couple of examples about what that looks like. British economy. If you can build a shed in a field outside a town, fill it with cheap stuff from China, and close down the entire high street of that town, that must be good, right? Another example. If you can buy all the available land for housing development and keep it and control it to push house prices higher and higher so that local people can't buy houses at a reasonable price and certainly can't get land to build a house, that must be good for everybody, right? If you're a bank and you can use your banking powers to influence government to allow you to speculate with almost no way of controlling or regulating it, and they can just keep doing this indefinitely, that must be good for all of us, right? If you can have the entire country's energy system in private ownership, Britain is the only country in Europe that does not own its national grid. Every single other country in Europe, all 27 other countries, own their national grid. Ours is owned by, in Scotland, by two multinational companies, and across the whole of Britain by six private multinational companies. They have a formula in place, which means that every penny they spend of investment in the energy system, they can pass on to you plus 5%. They cannot lose. It is impossible to lose if you're an energy company. So they can charge you what they want, and you've got no option because you need your electricity and your gas. So that must be good for us all, right? Let's rewind that. Let's go and look at what it would look like if you were living in, say, a Nordic country, or even some of the Germanic countries. Germany is so much better than us in this. German country, Nordic economy. They have a strong focus on local economies, because local economies are important. A local economy, a local business, not only trades locally, but you know this, if they break a window, they'll get a local joiner in. If they need electricity to work, they'll get a local electrician in. That is how you have strong local economies, by having economies where the ownership is in your local area and the supply chains are in your local area, so the wealth is spread in your local area. And that's what creates growth. That's how they do it in Nordic economies. Of course, they have supermarkets, but nothing like the way that we've allowed our supermarkets to close everything down. Housing. Well, let's pick the German example there. In Germany, you know, young people, they don't want mortgages. Millstone around their neck, they move. They live, they're young, they have access to really, really high quality public sector rental housing, which looks every bit as good as any of the yuppie flats in Glasgow. Really good high quality housing. They don't want to own houses. It's not until you get into your 40s that you start to think about maybe having a mortgage and settling down. Their house prices have not risen in 20 years. Their house supply is great. It is a completely different model. The housing market is not used to extract wealth from the people. Let's pick the banking sector in Japan or Germany. In both these countries, over 75% of the banking market is either publicly owned or collectively owned. Yes, that's right, little backwater Germany, little useless Germany that can't do anything. Their banking is publicly owned. Their banks give you a current account, they keep your money, they give you a card. If you need a loan, they'll give you a loan. If you need a mortgage, you can get a mortgage. And apart from that, they'll leave you the hell alone. Nobody phones you up and says, when did you last have a customer service review? Would you like to borrow lots of money? Your loan, have you seen you've only borrowed £20,000? You're probably squeezing another £10,000 in. Would you like that? I've nothing to spend it on. Oh, yeah, I'm sure you'll find something. We'll come around and give you it anyway. That's not what their banks do. Their banks are boring. Boring banks that do what you want. And they don't rip their customers off. Or energy. If you look at what we could do with energy in this country, we could take our energy system back into collective ownership almost for nothing, the grid, because we've already paid for it. You know, we've paid as customers for all of the infrastructure, so we don't have to pay compensation for it. We could just take it back into collective ownership. We wouldn't privatise the companies. Just say Scottish Power, Scottish Southern Electricity, we'll put you in a contract to do the maintenance. You build it. We'll own it, but we'll tell you where. Because another fantastical thing about our energy system, which is that in the car park of Kirky Miners Welfare, they found a magical stone that gave you endless energy. We still couldn't make our energy companies put the national grid connected to it. There's no one in their interest, they can just say, nah, we're not going to do that. If we had collective ownership, we can plan our electricity for us. We can give them a contract to maintain it, we plan it, we design it. And the next generation of energy supply, because almost all of our energy generation is going to die over the next 20 years, must be replaced. All of the coal-fired, gas-fired, nuclear-fired power stations. We're all going to have to replace them anyway. So how do we want to replace them? There's two ways we could do it. We could use the British model. The British model involves a multinational corporation paying a lot of money to a super-rich private landlord to put a whole bunch of wind farms, wind turbines on his land. They will buy the wind turbines cheap in China. And so what happens is this. The landowner gets rich, the corporation gets rich, the Chinese manufacturing company gets rich, and you get the bills. That's the British model. There's another way we can do this, and it's very easy. We own the grid. We take the, if we're going to build land, we compulsorily purchase it, so it's our land. We put the turbines on it, and because we own the grid and because it's our company, we decide where they're made. So hey, let's make them in Glasgow. That's tens of thousands of high-quality jobs immediately. Make our own turbines and put them on that land. And who gets the benefit? Every bit of it comes to us, because it's our land, and it's our turbines, and it's our wind, and they're our jobs, and it's our wealth. We can choose how we do this. That is how countries which have wealthy citizens do it. They plan their economy not in a me-first way that lets the biggest bully win, but in an all-of-us-first way, in a way that helps to put the interests of everybody first. Now, I just gave you the example of energy. We can do this again, over and over. Housing is another thing whereby you're guaranteed the revenue. Once you build a house, it creates rental value over 30, 40 years. So why don't we borrow over 30, 40 years like a mortgage? We set up a national housing company. We borrow against those future rents. We build the best conceivable quality of public rental housing. Britons have the smallest floor space of any country in Europe. We build tiny, tiny little houses. Let's build proper houses. Let's build them well. Let's make houses that people want to live in. Let's undermine this rubbish property development market that knocks up badly insulated, badly built houses that are not even designed to survive 20 or 30 years. In fact, I'm going to tell you, I wasn't going to get into this, but if you don't know this, it's really interesting. As an architect on our board, Malcolm Fraser is brilliant, and he will tell you that the housing industry is not about housing. Nothing to do with housing whatsoever. It's a land trading body. It just so happens that the best way to realise the value of land is stick houses on it. But if you want to make the money from the land, don't make the houses last. Knock them up fast, sell the land, and wait, because in 30 years, that housing estate will now be undesirable and the value will have dropped. You can buy it back, knock the houses down and start again. That is the UK's economic model. If you're a developer, what you do is you develop that bit and then that bit and then that bit and then that bit. By the time you're around here, that one's falling apart, so you start again. You know this. If you look at housing estates that were bought 25 years ago, remember that they were built 25 years ago. Remember when they were the shiny new places to live. And look at them now. They weren't properly built. We can change this. We can take the land collectively. We can use it to build houses collectively. And once again, when we do this, when it's us building the houses for us, we can decide how and where to build. Once again, this is tens of thousands of jobs that we can create, high-skilled jobs that pay, that we can create now. That we can do this now without borrowing or borrowing against rent. This is not about taxing. This is not about subsidy. This is about how you manage your economy. And I'll give you one last example of this before I'll wander on to some other subject for a second or two. We can do more than this. We can start to see what has failed in our economy. There is no investment. Okay, I'm going to do this now. Investment. The expenditure of time, money and effort now in the hope that it will make the future better. My God, is that a better concept than investment? If you take all of the private sector investment that's taking place in Britain today, all the private sector investment, and all the public sector investment, and all the private investment. So private investment might be you doing a course in computing to upgrade your skills, or it might be you investing in your house, putting an extension in your house. You add all that investment up, and then you subtract depreciation. So depreciation is how much you've got to spend just to stand still. So if you do all the investment in Britain, and then you subtract the depreciation, you get a negative number. We are negatively investing in Britain. We're not spending enough money to keep where we are. We need to find ways to invest. And there's a reason for this. I was going to keep it simple, but I can't help with it. I've started moving. There's a reason for this, and it's because we run our currency, we run our economy for speculation. The way that sterling is managed, if you borrow sterling at lunchtime and you haven't made a profit by tea time, you've done something wrong. The idea that anybody borrows sterling over a period of 5 or 10 years nowadays, it doesn't happen. It's not how it works. Sterling is a speculative currency. We keep the interest rates incredibly low so that you only have to make very small profits to make a profit. And so that's how they do it. What they do is they make small profits again and again and again. Maybe 20, 30, 40 trades in a day, each one making a small profit. But what that does is it squeezes out real investment. The kind of people that say, I'd like to build a factory that creates and builds things, and creates good jobs. You can't borrow like that in this country. So we have to do things to change that. We need a national investment bank. £5 billion of capitalisation isn't even much money, easy to find. With a borrowing, a liquidity ratio of 20 to 1, I'm explaining that thing once, that means we've got an investment bank of £100 billion to invest over the next 20 years in Scotland immediately. We could do lots of things. We can create national mutual companies. If we've got an economy with great opportunities and no one's taking advantage of it, because that's what's happening in Scotland, we have so many opportunities and no one's taking advantage. The expertise in our universities, the land, you know, we've got the biggest desert in Europe in the north of Scotland. Mile after mile after mile of potentially useful land, which is completely unused. It's used for speculation. It's borrowed. You know who owns our land? And you know why? The people that own our land is David Cameron's dad. I think he's got 40,000 acres. Paul Dacre, the edits the Daily Mail, he's got 10,000 acres. Ben, whatever the hell his name is, please don't go later, his daddy-in-law.
Westminster, Duke of Westminster. The Grosvenor.
100,000 acres? And what do they do with the land? Well, the crucial thing is, they can't do anything with it. Because the purpose of that land is you buy it, the price rises, and you sell it. It's an investment. And the problem with investments of that sort is, they're worth way more. The investment is worth way more than the actual land. And the problem is, if you let people start to farm that land or build stuff on the land, people will suddenly know, wait a minute, this land's worth 5 times as much as you can actually make out of it. So the key thing with land is don't let the people on it. Because if you let the people on it, that will reduce its value. And that's why the north of Scotland is the biggest desert in Europe. We could take that land back and use it. There is an amazing range of things that we could do up there. Biomass. We've got all this land. We're a cold country. We need heat. Why are we not planting large-scale biomass to cut down and make fuels which we can use to fuel our cities? All the land, all the cold, what's stopping us? We don't have mechanisms. So one suggestion from us is a national mutual company. Everyone in the country gets one non-tradable share. Every citizen gets one non-tradable share in a company. We can borrow in that company like you borrow in any other company. We use that money to buy and invest in enterprises. Perhaps it's biomass. Perhaps it's saying Scotland's expertise in shipbuilding could quickly adapt to make hydrogen-powered ships, the future of eco-shipping. Hydrogen-powered eco-icebreakers to go over the Arctic. You know that it's 40% quicker to get from China to Europe via the Arctic in Scotland than it is to go through the Panama Canal. We could be a key trading hub for all of the trade between China and Europe if we want to do that. Now, is a multinational corporation doing this for us? No. Do we need to find another way to do it?
I think we do.
I think we need to be brave and we need to try. Because all of this does something really important. What it does is it creates skilled industry. You pay for skills and you don't pay for no skills. So if we have all these speculative industries, you don't pay people. What skill is there putting a t-shirt and a coat hanger? What skill is there buying 5 houses and waiting 5 years for the value rises, selling and buying 10 and so on? What skill is there ripping off small businesses as a bank when they've got nowhere to go? There's no skill involved in that, so nobody gets paid. Build things, make things, do things. This makes wealth, it makes productivity, it makes your balance of trade, it means you can export, and it means that you pay your workforce again. That's what happens in the Nordic countries, that's what happens in Germany, that's what happens in Austria. We can turn this around. All of these are straightforward. Everything I have mentioned here is done now in another country like Scotland, not far away from us. Nothing is makey-uppy. Nothing is imaginary. This is the reality of life for people who don't live in Britain. Can we turn this around? How long will it take us to have enough people in this country that can build a wind turbine? 6 months? Something like that? How long will it take us to create one of these German-style house factories that can build really high-quality houses and assemble them for people. It'd be a year. Anyone that told you this will take a generation is simply lacking ambition. If we want to do this, we can do this much faster than they. So what do we need? Simple. We need power. The only thing that makes this work is power. And what gives you power? Independence gives you power. That's the one thing that you never hear the other side addressing. Independence gives you power. It's about you. Because this is the crucial thing. They talk about power and strength a lot, but they mean their power and strength. Because you know that in Britain, your opinion doesn't greatly matter. We have a parliament that doesn't listen. We have a size of economy, a size of country, in which your vote is small, your voice is small. Jesus, all of Scotland's voice is small. You know, it's not a big, we don't get that voice. What's the first thing that voting yes does? It multiplies, it amplifies your voice by 12 times. What you think in an independent Scotland is 12 times more important than what you think in Britain, because Britain is big and captured. So if you vote yes, you have a higher voice, you have more say, you have more power and you have more control. Is this the country you wanted? Not what any of the opinion polls say. People want their Royal Mail in collective ownership. People want the trains in collective ownership and energy in collective ownership. They want the banks regulated. They want proper investment in the public sphere, in services and in infrastructure. Are they getting it? No. Why are they not getting it? Because their voice isn't loud enough. In this country, in Britain, your voice isn't loud enough if you're not a banker. In Scotland, your voice is 12 times louder. That democracy, that ability for you to say, no, this is my country and this is how I want it. That voice is what changes things, because in the end, our problem is a problem of power. We have been subjected to the power of the banks and the corporations and the military and the arms manufacturers and all the rest. Their power shapes our country. And there's only one way to phase down that power, and it's the power of democracy. Only the power of democracy can beat the power of corporations. Only the power of democracy. And what is the power of democracy? The power of democracy is the ability for ordinary people to say, no, enough, I don't agree, and be listened to. Is that happening in Britain? God, no. Is that an Irish word? Is that happening in Britain? No, definitely not. Could it happen in Scotland? Would it happen in Scotland? I believe it would. I've talked in town halls like this night after night after night for 2 years now. And the people there, when I talk to them, they say, afterwards they come up and say, I want that. I want that. That's the country I want to live in. So why can't they have it? They can. Just believe that we have the ability, everything we need. We have the resources, we have the people power that we generate in our universities and our schools is amazing. Amazing people, the Scots, because of the education system that we have. We've got among the greatest resources in Europe. Our land, our wind, our sea, our geostrategic position. We have wealth. There's wealth in Scotland if we use it well. We are a modern economy with great infrastructure. It's not good enough, but it's great. I mean, it's genuinely advanced infrastructure that we've got in this country. We have everything we need. And we know what's wrong. I hope I've been able to explain some of what is wrong with Britain, of some of why it doesn't work, some of what it's done that's failed its people. So we know what's wrong. And we know the people who've done it better. Almost everybody, incidentally, has done it better. But we know who's done it better, and we know why and how they did it better. And this is what we did with the Commonweal Project. We said, how do we change this? Only using examples of things which have been tried somewhere else in the world. It's tried and shown to work. So that's what we did. We created a vision for how it could be different, only selecting things that work elsewhere. We've got everything we need. We've got all the people and all the assets. We have the knowledge, we have the expertise, we lack one thing. We lack the power. If we have the power to do this, we can do it, and I believe that we will. If we vote no, we vote to accept this and get back down in our seats, watching reality TV and another programme which is called The Great British Something, unless it's called The Britannia Something, or it's called I Love My Country. It'll be one of these things. You can sit down, you can watch that until the Queen has time for another jubilee, or we can get another royal baby squeezed out. You can enjoy that when you go back to your low wages. You can have great fun with all this stuff as Piers Morgan tweets contemptuous shit at you. That's what you can have if you vote no. And if you vote yes, we can have whatever we want because it comes our choice. What is the quandary? What is the question? We can do this. For the love of God, vote yes and don't be scared, because there are so many people in this country who are so ready now to stand up and take us forward. Don't let them down. Don't let themselves let yourselves down. We are ready to do this. Scotland is ready now. We are ready to go. We are good to go. Vote yes and we're off.
Thank you, Robin. I was just going to point out that Robin's actually the director of the Jimmy Reid Foundation. I'm not so sure he would have done so well with the Winnie Bevy and...
I wouldn't get through this so far.
Speech, I counted at least four swear words in there. If everybody else could refrain from that, as I said before, just to remind you, no talking over each other, and heckling is for idiots that are drunk in comedy clubs, not for public meetings where we're discussing serious issues. So if you have something to say, stick your hand up and we'll give it to our speakers here. They can answer you directly.
Just a few points. It's not for you, it was a great speech you had. I believe every word of it. Just a couple of things for the people in here.
Can you hear me?
He's got a microphone.
We've got a microphone coming.
Hello? Just a couple of things that it doesn't come across in the media. I think television, newspapers, everything is being letting us down because they're not bringing forward the facts that are going to affect you. I've jotted down just a few of them here. I'd like to just go through them with you because they will affect the future of this country. Whether you vote yes or no, but the first one is this carry on about the pound. The pound, first of all, the Federal Bank of America is a private bank, okay? The government has got nothing to do with it. The Bank of England is a private bank. They borrow from the Bank of England. So it's the Bank of England that would back the pound. It isn't anything to do with the Scottish, the English government saying, you'll not get the pound. I don't know any bank in the world that would refuse to underpin the Scottish pound. You know what I mean? Especially the Federal Bank of America would jump in with both feet, the size of the economy in Scotland. I can remember, I was on the Cormorant platform in the early days, putting a 300-foot mast and talking for the communications of the North Sea. And I can tell you, at that time, they were test drilling in the west, and they also test drilled in the east coast. They found oil in the west and the east. The problem was the west coast, it was very deep, and we didn't have the deep drilling technology at that time. The west coast is only 600 feet between Norway and Shetland, and that was the easy oil, they call it. So they started drilling on that side. The reason I'm mentioning that is because there used to be 15 major oil fields in the world that supplied the world. There's now four, and they four have been in decline for many years, meaning they haven't pumped oceans of seawater down to get the last of the oil up. The projection for the oil is 10 to 15 years for these oil fields around the world. So the potential for our North Sea is massive, and they talk about 1.3 trillion left in the East Coast. That'll easily double within the next 10 to 15 years. 1.5 trillion is 150,000 million pounds. That's how much it is. People don't seem to grasp what these figures are. Scotland's got a massive amount of money in tourism and whiskey and all the rest of it. But anyway, we'll come off of that now. We'll move on to things like India and China are going to ramp up to 60% over the next 10 years, meaning they are going to get the last of the oil that's coming from abroad. That's what will drive the prices so high. So we're really looking at 3 trillion. We're looking at 300,000 million pounds just in the North Sea without even touching the West Coast. You know, you'll wonder why.
Can I just stop you before you go too much further? We're looking for questions. I know you've got a lot to say about the oil thing.
Well,
have you got a question
attached? As fast as I can, right.
How many have you got? Because there's quite a lot of people in the audience.
More, say nothing about the hiring appearances because they're all very.
If we could stay on things that apply to the century.
There were more appearances as well.
They say, there'll be no way back. No way back to what? No way back to successive governments that ruined the wide-based industry of the whole of Britain. They also wiped out every part of the coal fields in Scotland. Threw thousands of people out of work, destroyed lots of families. There's no way back to that. Other things are things like bring in the poll tax. We didn't wear it in Scotland for too long, but they tried to push it in. They pushed the bedroom tax in. They pushed in things like you'll pay for all your prescriptions. It's been a continuous, the track record of the English governments in Scotland are absolutely abominable. And I just don't know why they can stand up there like Alistair Darling and them and tell so many lies and have a net to turn round to the Scottish people and say, there'll be no way back.
We really do need to open this up for questions. Can I take some more questions? We are looking for questions.
This might not be totally relevant to what the speakers have said, but the one thing I find very confusing, we're talking about breaking away from the Westminster government and establishing our own government independently in Scotland. I haven't heard any suggestion that we are going to become a republic. I have heard that we want to keep the pound, we want to keep the Queen. So how does that stack up with this constant banging on about leaving the United Kingdom? If we've still got the monarchy, we've still got the same Queen, then we still have the United Kingdom. We are leaving Westminster, we're not leaving the United Kingdom. Therefore, all these fear tactics that are going on about if we leave the United Kingdom, we won't be able to be part of NATO, we won't be able to be part of the European Union, the greatest thing this week, Mark Lawson, the Edinburgh Festival will no longer be part of the UK cultural scene. So if we're only leaving the Westminster government, we're not leaving the monarchy, how come we're leaving the UK?
Can I ask John to answer that one? Because I think this is more his field.
But we're not leaving the UK.
Yeah, but they keep on telling us
that we're not leaving the UK. Jackie Bailey, that well-known Labour intellectual, told us the other week that if we get independence, England will be further away from Scotland geographically. She said that. She never told us who's going to saw through the border, but she said that. Don't believe a word of it. Look, whatever happens in Scotland after independence, we decide. The electorate of Scotland decides. If we want to be a republic, we can be a republic. If we want to be a monarchy, we can be a monarchy. It will be a democratic decision, and we can do what we like. There are no holds barred, anything goes, but it will be democracy that will do it. There will be a United Kingdom immediately afterwards, because there was a United Kingdom before the Union.
Yes.
There was a United Kingdom 100 years before the Union. So it doesn't matter. They'll just lie to you.
You're the only person I have heard saying we are not leaving the United Kingdom. They've been banging on about this for donkeys. I have never once heard Alex Salmond saying we're not leaving the United Kingdom. I've never once heard Nicola Sturgeon saying we're not leaving the United Kingdom.
Well, he kind of does because he says we're going to still have the Queen, right?
Yeah, but he has never publicly contradicted the people who say we're leaving the United
Kingdom.
Well,
unlike me, Alex Salmond has to watch what he says.
I know. But I think that's something that has to be made clear. We are leaving Westminster, we're not leaving the United Kingdom.
Can I have any more questions that we've got from the floor? I'm sure there must be plenty before. We've got another one. It seems like the front row are doing well here.
Hello. Right, well, first of all, again, thank you for two very good presentations there. The and pardon my accent as well.
But don't worry about it. No.
You're the welcome.
An accident of
birth. I particularly agree with virtually everything you're saying about what's going on with the economy and what can be done. What I don't really see at the moment is how you're going to be able to control, even as an independence party, how we are going to be able to control and do away with what was nearly called Robert, well, I won't say that, the Robert balance, because they still hold the power in literal sense as well as in the metaphorical sense. So there's going to be one heck of a fight for a start, and a large part of that fight will be in the negotiations between Scotland Westminster. How are you going to deal with that? Because there's no getting away from the fact that with the National Grid, or what used to be the National Grid, that's built as a unified system throughout Britain. And the same more or less applies to the other major infrastructures. So there's going to be a job, a real difficult job, to negotiate from a position of power, despite the fact that there may be a very powerful yes vote. There's lots of people in the rest of Britain who have very powerful voices as far as the electorate is concerned, but that doesn't mean the government takes any notice of it. And that certainly doesn't mean that the top 0.1% are going to relinquish their power in any easy way at all.
Right. Okay. That's a range of very, very interesting questions, and all of them are very important, but I don't worry about them, and I'll tell you why. In order. One, despite what I said, I don't blame the corporations. They act like psychopaths when they're encouraged to act like psychopaths. If you look at the very same corporations operating in the Nordic countries, they don't act like psychopaths. We can't blame the corporations for not paying corporation tax if we let them not pay corporation tax. We can't blame them for abusing planning laws if we create planning laws which are designed for abuse. In truth, it's not the corporations' fault. Their job is to make the most profit they can in the environment they're given. It's our fault. We let them, the elite, particularly the big four accounting firms, create a range, an environment in which they can do these things. It's our fault. Now, every time I hear people say, but the corporations are run, hold on a minute, has anyone been to the Nordic countries? They pay high wages, and they've got shops too. You know, they've got shops in their high street. H&M works in, well, it's cut from the Nordic countries. Marks and Spencer's operates there. It's not a wasteland. Every corporation will work to the environment it's given. And if that's the environment it's given, that's what it'll do. So the first thing to say is that it's about how you deal with, it's about the environment in which you create for them. And the second thing to say is, I've never said that this doesn't take hard work, it takes hard work. And one of the things which you've got to get over is the get-rich-quick strategies of Britain. The belief that there's a magic button, you can press that and it'll fix everything. There's no magic button. The only thing that matters is everything you do. So the Thatcherite thing, if we cut interest rates, everything else will fix itself. If we deregulate, everything else will fix itself. If we cut taxes, everything else will fix itself. This isn't true. It was never true. It's everything you do that matters. And you've got to take every step and you see, what does this thing do? Does it make things better? Does it make things worse? How do we make sure that it makes things better? That's a mindset that we've got into. And nor do I say that that utopia is round the corner. Partly because literally utopia means no such place. Utopia is somewhere you try for, it's not somewhere you reach. But no, we can't do that. It's a different world than the post-war period. We have a whole range of international treaty organisations, the World Trade Organization, the International Monetary Fund, the European Union. They have rules, and those rules are quite restrictive. And they don't allow you to do the kind of protectionist thing that some countries do. They don't allow you to take entire industries into collective ownership without compensation and all that kind of thing. The point is, though, that if you look at the spectrum of everybody who also operates within these rules, we're at the bottom. So it's not, can we break the ceiling and become the best country in the world? One day. For the time being, can we get off the bottom of what's possible and get towards the top of what's possible? And so this is the power thing. Within the power constraints that we've got, we can still do a lot better. And then the next thing about power is, and this is a really reassuring thing, and I could put it like this, imagine a world without the Daily Mail. I can't see how the Daily Mail could print in Scotland. Because, you know, it's Southern News isn't going to be relevant afterwards. So vote yes to get rid of the Daily Mail and close the meeting. But once you have these power systems, and remember, the British establishment and the British power elite is very powerful. The Scottish establishment, the Scottish power elite, looks quite powerful. But that's only because they've got the British power elite standing right behind them. Take away the UK military, take away the UK civil service, take away the City of London, take away all of that ingrained power, and tell me who's powerful in Scotland. Where is this power block? Actually, what we're going to have, I think, afterwards, is a remarkable period of readjustment of power. Because I don't think they can fill it as fast as we can fill it. But, you know, this power goes. I just see this again. Something like the David Hume Institute, which is a right-wing think tank. How many votes do you think they could get if they stood for a party? Once you make it democracy and not an elite, then suddenly power comes back to people. And this is an important thing. Power comes back to people in those circumstances. How do we get there? I will put my hand up and say I'm a bit worried. I like the white paper mostly. It's a good starting point. There's mistakes in it. They're wrong about energy, they're wrong about banking regulation, and they're very wrong about the corporation tax cut. But broadly, it's a pretty good white paper. But it may or may not become policy. There's going to be an election. And it's too timid for my mind. It's very much, I see the white paper as the last gasp of Westminster, not the first breath of New Scotland. I think once we get into that New Scotland, we begin. The key thing for people is to win. See, when you get a little win, the next win seems easier. When you get that win, your confidence is up and the next one seems easier. Once we're out, once we get that first win, once we vote yes, and we start to build a coherent modern country, everybody's going to start to go, what was that fuss about? What was it that we couldn't do? And the fearty stuff, the fearty element, which does kind of float around, not so much the white paper, but some of what I think the SNP said about negotiations, I think they've been too weak. Some of that stuff will start to disappear quickly. What I do agree is I'm a little bit worried about the period before the next election. So we've got the period after yes, but before the 2016 election. And the SNP is the best of mainstream parties in Britain, but that's not saying all that much. You know, that's not a very high base to be the best of mainstream parties in Britain.
Yes.
And there's some very good people in the SNP that's got some good stuff, but I think they've been far too timid in negotiation. When it comes to negotiation, this is the point I've tried to ram home every time I do these meetings. Can anybody in here, apart from possibly a formal currency union, I'm assuming someone's going to ask about currency in a minute, apart from formal currency union, what do we want from Britain? What is it that we've got, they've got that we want? Because I can't think of anything. Right, what is it that we've got that they want? That's different. Above all, they want us to take £6 billion a year of their debt. Now, it is their debt. It is them who unilaterally said that Scotland will be thrown out as a successor nation, not a continuing nation. Now, this is a bit complicated. There's a thing called the Vienna Conventions. The Vienna Conventions, the international convention which defines the breakup of nation states. And there's two things that you can be. You can either be two continuing nations, which means, in effect, the two parts of the nation that breaks up move ahead with exactly the same rights and responsibilities as each other. Westminster has ruled this out unilaterally. I think they're wrong to do it. I think it's a misreading of international law, but they have ruled it out. The other version is you have a continuing state and a successor state. So the continuing state is the one that continues and is the same, and the successor state is a fresh start, out with no rights and no responsibilities. Now, that is unilaterally what Westminster has said. Scotland will be a successor state. Now, actually, magic. Because again, what is it that they've got that we've lost?
Debt.
But the debt is absolutely 100% definitely not ours. Now, that does not mean I'd walk away from the debt. Because if I could walk away from that debt, and that debt would fall on the elite in London that created it, I'd be off like a shot. But it won't. It'll fall on the working people of England, Wales and Ireland. So we should take a proportion of the debt, but on our terms, and that's what they're negotiating. So I'll give you some of the terms I would have. One, 25% write-off of all the debt with a wealth tax in London. If they don't do it, that's their call. We'll take 25% off anyway, because it's voluntary. Next, once we've got that, if they make us start a new currency, we'll take the cost of that off. So we'll take that off as well. If they refuse to give us assets, we'll just keep taking stuff off. and then we'll have a low level of debt at the end. And once we come out with that low level of debt, we will give that back, we will pay that debt back. But I, first of all, I think we should call it the British aid payment. A sort of aid payment we pay Britain because they're the mess they got themselves into. I think we should pay it from an international development budget. So we'll give some money to Malawi and we'll give some money to England. And as we give the money to the rest of the UK, I suggest, why do we even bother giving it to Westminster? We don't have to. It's a model payment. We could just set up development companies in the north, the Midlands, Wales, Cornwall, give it straight to them, bypass Westminster altogether. Now what I'm trying to explain here is, the only thing that they've got in their armoury is if we go in there saying that it's formal currency pact or nothing. That gives them the cards. That's why I personally would go in and say, it's up to you. Give us a good deal in a currency union, we're off. So I do not see what the hell it is that they've got, apart from bluff and bluster, that standard eating thing of course we like. Herschel, what? You may be from Eton, but you're the one that's carrying £1.8 trillion of debt. I mean, we've not. So if you want to brain and go on about your father's yacht, knock yourself out. We'll just go away here and start building a new country. So I do not believe that Scotland is a supplicant. Quite the contrary. If there was a yes vote, we could do surprisingly well by just saying, well, no bother, we go see it. You just keep everything. You keep the lot, we're off. We'll build our own warships, and we'll whatever, we'll do that, fine. We're off. I think we're in the strong position if we play it right. So, in every one of these things, I'm never, never sanguine or dismissive of power. Power will always try to pull more power in. And that's natural. It's just that the suck of power in independent Scotland will be at least for 5 to 10 years, massively smaller than the current suck of power. And in that window, there is so much that we can do. And I'm not going to talk far too much altogether, but there's a whole range of things. I should have said, all of this is in a book that we wrote, and I'd like to bring some copies, but we run out of music in the back of my car. You can get it on our website, allofusfirst.org, and it's £6. It'll explain all of this kind of all the way through in one go. But one of the things that we can do is you can structure your democracy in a way that power can't influence it so much. We have the most centralised democracy in Europe. In fact, we've got the most centralised democracy in the West, in the developed world. If you put local democracy back out to communities, then they get the power, and it's harder for corporations to catch them. If you put participatory democracy structures in government, and you make those constitutional, then it's much, much harder for corporations to bend and twist it to their will. So in that window, there is a lot that we can do to structurally build a democratic system which is much more effectively insulated from power. The Murdochs of this world will not disappear. It's not going to be a case of, oh, right, Scotland gone, then we'll just let them live in their organic utopia. That's not going to be how it is, but our ability to fight back and structure things will be massively better than it currently is in the Westminster State. My God, that's a long answer, sorry.
We've got more questions. Before we do that, I think Robin doesn't know this, but I think I'm probably the only professional negotiator in the room. One of the things that became very obvious to me after the Salmond and Darwin debate, sorry, you sat a rebel in politics, you fell off my sneak fell up my head. One of the things you don't do, and one of the things he was desperate to get, was a plan B. And he used the phrase plan B, plan B, plan B about 1,500 times in his little spiel. What you don't do in a negotiation, and let me put this in layperson's terms for those of you who get wage rises, but you don't want a negotiation as a trade union official and say, we're demanding 5%, but don't worry, we'll settle for 2. You don't do that in a negotiation, and therefore the plan B nonsense, which sounds very strong when you've got, you know, a dozen newspapers and some very friendly people at the BBC repeating it for you all the time, actually isn't a flyer for anyone who does real negotiations. It's just not how negotiations work. This gentleman here in the grey jacket's got a question.
I would like to ask the top table if they know a very portly gentleman called Alex Salmond. I've written several times, and it's very critical. I have taught angling all over the world. I've talked to hundreds of thousands of people. All my Scottish anglers are infuriated because Alec allowed the nets another month and paid money into rearing more salmon. And all the anglers are up and arms, where I had a normal yes, 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 the whole no, and the P. And in my letters to him, and very rude, no reply, I warned him he's losing at least 500,000 votes amongst these Anglos. It might not seem important to people, but I think that could sway it one way or another.
Can I just, before I ask either the panel to put a comment about that, you should know as an audience that none of the people on this panel are representatives from the SNP. I'm not a party member, I'm not aware that John is a party member and Robin's definitely not a party member. So the concept that the whole guest campaign centres around the SNP, well, they're an integral part to this. They fought for us to get to this point where we actually have a referendum, and for that I'm truly grateful to them. They are not the be-all and end-all of the guest campaign, so none of us here on this panel will be able to phone Alex Salmond tonight and tell him that the fishermen are very unhappy. What I would say is I did speak to someone who was involved in European negotiations around fisheries policy in the North Sea, and what I was told by the minister that was involved from Scotland in that is that actually they cannot speak to the European Union about fisheries policy in Scotland without permission from Westminster. They actually can't speak to them directly in negotiations without permission from Westminster. So I don't think that answers your question particularly about salmon fishing specifically. I think the fact that power over that subject will come back to a government which you can choose to boot out.
No, they're
not
doing the motivation of anglers.
This isn't sea fishing, this is angling from rivers, and that is devolved.
Yeah.
So the answer is that, I say again, the SNP's, I think, by a little way, the best of mainstream parties in Britain just now. But, like I say, that's not to withhold criticism. There's a number of things they've done recently, because I think it were a mistake, incidentally. Of those things, what I have found most often, because I work with government, is that a lot of this is the government, the politicians, failing to stand up to the civil servants. So a lot of this stuff is done in technical notes. The civil servants say, there you go, sir, this is the quickest answer. And often that's done on the basis of lobbying from commercial interests and various things. Now, my view, the job of a government is to keep an eye on the civil servants, not the other way around. And this is particularly true in Britain. But remember, we got all those powers devolved, but we didn't get the civil service not devolved. The civil service answers only to Whitehall. The career structure is only to Whitehall. Promotion is only to Whitehall. What I've heard quite a lot, the angling is bad, because someone actually raised this with me, we've got a small paper coming on a commons for angling, for the fishings. But it was bad. I mean, there's others that I think that it'd been worse. I think the procurement bill is a massive missed opportunity. I think the first run they took at land reform was so underwhelming. I think they made a number of things that they should have done better. But one of the key things with this is that they are doing this on the basis of a UK civil service that provides that kind of advice to them. So for that reason, I think that what you will find is, again, the last 4 years of SNP government is the tail end of the old order. That's what government looks like with the UK civil service still in control. I think what you'll find is afterwards, what you're looking at is something different. But if I can just be honest and share my slight frustrations, if you've got a lot of your friends who have been kind of turned off to that, you have no idea how many of the people in my kind of circles and wider community have been turned off with the corporation tax cut. I mean, I've told them it's just a mistake.
Still 500,000 people, a lot of people.
Oh, I know. And the problem is we've got 4 weeks to go, reversing the legislation isn't going to be possible. We're just going to have to try and make the best possible case we can about all the other stuff. And I will now remember to say that our anglers need to be protected as well.
One, two.
Yeah, shall I quiz them and everything? But yeah, listen, I'm not unsympathetic at all. It's just that the 4 weeks to go, like I say, we have to focus on these big questions. And it's not about Alex Salmond or one person. It's a stupid thing. I don't know if anyone heard Tommy's coming, I can see. Tommy Sheridan was a great thing about, you could buy a new house, you could ruin. He said, this is the perfect house, this is the house I dreamt of. And the estate agent says, oh, is it lovely? He said, yeah, the house, the space is great, the garden's great, the school's great, the whole thing. But I'm not going to buy it. And the estate agent says, why is that? I didn't like wallpaper. That's how crazy it is to say I'm voting no because of one politician. And when Tommy tells you that, you come out laughing as if he ever stole his joke.
I apologise for the hijacking of a radio mic signal with the deep breathing individual who seems to think that's a way of testing microphones really quickly. It's not.
The day the thing goes through there, but it's coming through here and not through there.
Okay, so if anybody shouts...
My number up! Have we got through there by any chance? Have we converted the entire...
If anybody shouts legs 11, it's not aimed at me. Do we have any other questions? Got a question right here at the back. The gentleman in the black.
That's the company.
Okay, I'm going to ask John to answer that.
I'm not an expert in the law or anything like that, but I'll tell you something. There's something seriously wrong when you allow the criminals in a society to run the drug industry, right? And you ask yourself who benefits from that. Let me tell you something. There's a literature in the United States academic world which looks at this, right? And what it tells you, it's quite honestly that underneath the surface, the deep state, the government is behind this, because one of the things that happens when you allow criminals to run a drugs industry is the money, you get a lot of liquidity and it finds its way into the banks and it helps to keep the banks liquid. And you can also use that black money to do black state things that states like to do in foreign countries, Iran-Contra being a classic example of it. So I've got a very deep suspicion of states which do drug prohibition, because like you say, if you get drugs in the under control of government and into the under control of medics, then you can start treating people with problems and you can stop criminals running the show. That's all I'd say.
Aye. I basically agree with that. I don't think I'm giving too much away. My part as a filmmaker, I was a student the whole thing. I've tried drugs, I've seen people who've done drugs, and you know, a lot of what people see being the Daily Mail is absolute nonsense. I've also seen people who have screwed their life up by using it badly. I take this very seriously, because I don't think that we're quite ready to go to, you know, a blanket decriminalisation of all drugs. But where I start is, one, what we're doing now is so obviously not working, I don't know why we're still doing it. It's clearly not working. The prohibition, there is no example of prohibition that's ever worked. Because the whole point of a prohibition is, as soon as you prohibit something, you put it into the hands of criminals its supply. So the first thing is, prohibition hasn't worked. The second thing is that the reason why we never change our drugs policies is crazy. And once again, it comes down to a small segment of the media. If you see anything about a different approach to drugs, the Daily Mail goes ballistic. As you will have seen in when Blair, there was the guy who was running the Drugs Commission for Tony
Professor Blair. Nutt.
not that's right. And unfortunately, but when he came out and says this isn't working, we should change, and the Daily Mail went ballistic and called for his head, so Tony Blair gave him
called for his nom.
Called for his head, and Tony Blair gave him his head and a plate and said, right, fine, we're gonna take him out of the job. Now this is the problem, is we can't have a rational debate about it. So the first thing is, again, I'd like to hope that the media environment in an independent Scotland enables us to have the debate. Personally, I think we ought to be decriminalising marijuana. It's not completely risk-free, but then neither is red wine, and it doesn't make sense. You know, it has no basis for it. But before I would advocate such a thing, I think we do need to do some serious work on a lot of the social impacts. Is it when can you drive? When can you not drive? Is it okay? What health advice do you give? How do you manage the supply? But in principle, I think that's what we've got to go to. I would absolutely immediately support the decriminalisation, but the medicalisation of other drugs. So if you don't know, in the 1960s in Britain, heroin addiction was a medical condition. You went to hospital and you got a prescription. And in that time, there were about 600 or 700 drug users in Scotland. It was actually pressure from the United States to reverse that law. And that law was scrapped at the end of the 60s. And in the space of about 2 years, the amount of heroin addicts in Scotland rose by about 100 times. Because immediately it became a criminalised activity, so people would buy it. Actually, in the 60s, heroin addiction was almost solely a problem of medical professionals. They were the only people that could get access to it. And then it was criminalised and suddenly became flooded the streets. We need a different approach. There's no question. There's only one thing in what you said that I would disagree with is whatever we do with this, I wouldn't do it as a money-making scheme. It might have that advantage. We might get that benefit. But bluntly, using drugs as a way of making money for somebody has been the root of the problem. Let's get the solution right based on health and well-being issues and social issues. You know, Holland doesn't do badly from its legalised marijuana trade. Interestingly, of course, the vast majority of the people that go there to use it are not from Holland. It's mainly British tourists that go over. They actually don't have we've got a higher rate of marijuana usage than they have in Holland, the joys of making something not a prohibited thing. But yeah, there's no question that there's all been all sorts of measurable social benefits that they've had from taking that approach, and I think we ought to be doing it. But let's have a proper debate. It's one of a number of areas where we just can't get a proper debate going. So one that I feel strongly about personally, and it's in a similar field, is voting rights for prisoners. When did a 6 month or a 1 year custodial sentence remove your complete citizenship? No right whatsoever to have any say about your society. And yet it's so toxic because of the way the media overreacts that you can't even have a conversation about these sorts of things. So yes, I would like to live in a country where we can talk about things maturely. And I'll tell you something which is really encouraging. See this debate, this independence debate, for all they tell you in the Better Together camp that it's all vicious and horrible and nasty, it's not. The most mature and grown-up political debate I've ever been involved in my life. People have, as we've heard here tonight, people who are not practicing academics or politicians or political think tank runners are having intelligent, grown-up conversation about complex matters, about currency, about debt, about the military, about all sorts of things. We are more than capable of having a grown-up discussion. Just give us the space to do it, and I think we will be able to do it. And as soon as we've got that chance, let's be honest, whatever decision we make, it's going to be better than what we're doing just now.
Just one interesting thing about Professor Nutt and his committee. They produced a league table of drugs according to harm, hazard. And right up there, above cannabis and above heroin even, I think, was alcohol, very interestingly. But they didn't bother touching that because there's quite a lot of people in the House of Lords and the House of Commons and the pals of the government make a lot of money out of alcohol.
I've got a lady here in a gay cardigan. So the light's not shining on me. And then I've got a gentleman over here.
Seth, have you seen politicians
debating
television like that?
We
have people like Robin.
Well, maybe not Robin? People like me, but my whole level, my whole feel, everything about this campaign that has been so great has been the breakdown of the divide between politics and people. It's the best thing. I talk in town halls most nights of the week, and this is normal. It is very rare for me to be in a panel with a politician. And I'm not being down on politicians. Well, I'm a little bit, but I've worked with them all my life. Broadly, most politicians get in, they're meaning well. And they do try to basically mean well, but they've just created this structure for themselves, and again, the media have done it for them, where they can't say what they think, because they've got to follow a line, and they can't disagree, because that's a split. And the pleasure and the joy of having a campaign where I've sat in panels and disagreed with the people in the panels, and no one jumping up and down and saying, oh, you see, no, there's a debate and a discussion, but it's positive and it's helpful. Now, this idea of, first of all, breaking down that barrier is one thing, and then, some of you have heard me tell this story before, the most important thing that anyone has said to me in 20 years of working in British politics was said to me by a working class granny in South Edinburgh. We're walking out, I mean, and she just came up to me and she says, thanks for the speech, I've never been involved in politics in my life, never done it before in my life, nothing. But this was so important for my grandkids, my grandwayne, she says. And incidentally, can I just say that, what is it with troublemaking grandparents? They always blame my grandwayne's. You're just a troublemaker, I'd be proud of it, you don't have to blame it in your way. Because of my grandwayne's, this is too important. So I decided I had to do something. So I signed up and I've been putting leaflets through the doors and I've been canvassing. And that was the announced this moment. She said this thing to me. The most important thing that anyone in British politics ever said. She said, see, when this is over, I'm not going back to my sofa. That was it. That was the moment when I said, this country is on the brink of a real change, where ordinary people think this country is theirs to engage in, to run into shape. And that, every time I tell that story, I think, great, really, tried what she told me. That story filled me with more enthusiasm than anything else that's happened in this campaign. And it's been a glorious campaign of wonderful responses. It's not me you want to tell, it's all of us. We've got to start somehow being engaged in the wider media, the social media, and town halls, community politics like this, coming out and engaging and telling people they're right or they're wrong. I've got to say, I disagree. I like the heckles. I quite like it. But I'm halfway through something, someone says, rubbish. It's great.
But they need heckle.
And they say, well, so what's wrong? And there's something about the old form of, I'm not saying I want eggs thrown at me, but that old form of being close enough to an audience that you can't lie to them, or you can, but they can hold you account for it. That's something that's wonderful. So the days of politicians, bluntly, the last thing I'm going to say is Alex Salmond is an incredibly talented politician. And he's a very, very capable politician. And I looked at that debate, and that looked like, to me, like a man who had advisors and that many coats of varnish on him. They couldn't move anymore.
Yeah.
Get the varnish off our politicians, let them be human, let them be themselves, speak honestly without somebody coaching them all the time on what to say and what not to say. They'll be more than perfect for it, and the people will like them so much better for it.
Two last questions here we're going to take before we finish so that these guys can actually have an evening.
Get with that. You're not talking away, and you don't need a microphone.
I would like to ask the panel, are we in recession or depression? Because one of the Tory papers a couple of weeks ago said that the current situation was a lot worse than the Wall Street crash. And do you think current economic model, repeating the same mistakes, might potentially take us down that road if we're not already there?
I'm going to get John to comment first, and then I'll
go. I'm not an economist, but I do read quite a lot of stuff in economics. The current model doesn't work because we've financialised the economy. We've got a whole load of financial instruments compounding at exponential rates, and they are not real wealth, they're fictitious capital, and they are a claim on real wealth. Until we sort that out, we're not going to get back to any form of normal economic progress. There is a huge growing tide of fictitious capital out there. We've got bubbles building up everywhere. The debt didn't go away. What we did was we got the Bank of England or the Bank or the Federal Reserve to print money and give it to the banks at zero interest rate and let them do what they like with it. We should have given it to the people to go and spend and create economic activity. And still we break, until we break the power of the banks, or do what Abraham Lincoln did in the Civil War, printed greenbacks and said, go and use them. We have a ludicrous economic system, a ludicrous system where we have privatised the production of money and we've allowed banks to do what they like with it, and it's a claim on the real economy, and until we break that up, we don't have a snowball's chance in hell of sorting things.
Ivan? Just to add to that, that the Western economics is very precise in terminology when things are rising. It's very vague on the way down. So what's the difference between a recession and depression? Whatever you want it to be. There is no technical differentiation whatsoever. The only, you can't easily compare, but the only reason why this crash hasn't had the massive social impact of the Wall Street crash is because we've got a welfare state in place.
Yeah.
If there hadn't been a welfare state, this wouldn't look like the 1920s.
Yeah.
We'd be in a Great Depression. That's the difference. This time round, technical term is counter-cyclical. Imagine if, as soon as the economy went down, you paid off all your teachers, you paid off all your doctors, you paid off all your social workers, your street cleaners, and so on. It's because, all of them, it's because the public sector keeps that going, whether there's an up or a down. It's called counter-cyclical. It works in the opposite direction of the economic cycle. So that's why it doesn't look like a depression, but it's woeful. And the problem is that the growth is, I mean, it's my four-year-old did this. I'd take it aside and have a word with her. The thing that caused the catastrophe off El Dun, would you do that again? My daughter was saying that, I'd say, look, the last time you poked that, a cat bit you. What are you doing? Didn't know I was going to talk about my cat all night. But, so that's the thing that's crazy. If you're interested in this, readfoundation.org and in our library, you'll find a paper by Jim Cuthbert, a very respected economist, used to be head of statistics in the Scotland office. And it basically explains seven key triggers which will bring down the UK economy again. And it's almost anything.
Yeah.
Virtually anything. In fact, I'll tell you this very, very quickly. What happened didn't happen in Britain. This is the only true thing that Gordon Brown says. It was British banks that did it, but they did it in America.
Yeah.
So subprime did come from America. It's British banks that largely did it, but it happened in America. And what happened was, this is called, it created what's called an economic shock. And an economic shock is any rapid change in the economy. And what an economic shock does is an effect tests what's there. So if you think about it like this, an economic shock comes from the US, shoots across the Atlantic. Ireland goes down, Britain goes down, Norway doesn't, Sweden doesn't, Finland doesn't, Denmark doesn't, France does a bit, Holland doesn't, Austria doesn't, Germany doesn't,
Canada.
Greece does, Canada doesn't, Greece does, Italy does, Spain does, Austria doesn't, Poland doesn't, Estonia barely does. So what in effect happened was, you got an economic shock that just revealed whose economies were shit. That's all that happened. It's us, Ireland, Greece, Italy and Spain. Everybody else was kind of an okay, well France as well, and their economy's pretty rubbish. Everybody else was fine. So what happened was, that this revealed who had the weak economies. Our economy is not only no better, it's arguably worse. And here's the petrifying thing, and nobody's asked about currency. Here's the petrifying thing, and one of the reasons why I'm worried about sterling. is there's only two standard neoclassical economic responses to a catastrophic failing in the finance sector. One is to cut interest rates and one's to throw money at the banks.
Yeah.
That's the only two standard responses. We can't cut interest rates any further because they're functionally at zero and we've got no money. So the question is, not will there be a crash? Because I think to some extent there will. It might not be quite as big, but there will, but it could be worse. The question is, if there is, what have we got left to do?
Nothing.
We will have to nationalise all the banks. We will have to print money at inflationary rates simply to underpin the economy. And then we will have to take rapid and very painful action, which should have been spread over 10 years. We should be dumping bad debt objects which exist in there. We should have been dumping them now. We should have been writing off 30% of the bank's assets because they're not real. We didn't do it. And what's going to happen is the next time round, we're going to have to write off 30% of their assets overnight. It is going to hurt so much. And one of the reasons why I'm worried about hanging about the Bank of England is when it all goes down, it'll take us down with it.
Yeah.
That's why I'm more than fearing
this. Yeah. Yeah.
close of notes, I think some of the bit you've mentioned earlier about like a dialogue would seem, and I've seen it personally at workplaces, with colleagues who for the first time have been actually empowered with a political debate in their life, which are actually intended to vote in. And a large chunk of even family members who have never been registered to vote. There's a lasting legacy in anything that will actually make sure that political dialogue goes forward.
You might want to make it closer to your...
All right. The question is to what extent the current polling reflects that missing group.
Mm.
And maybe the vote's a lot closer than we'd be led to believe. And maybe to what extent we get a lot more people out. But maybe the onus is on us all to get a high turnout. And to make sure that missing group are actually registered for voting time. And we may well actually find we might actually get the result we anticipate.
Right, and bloody cameras, I never usually talk about polls in camera because it's way better for the other side to think they're winning than to put them straight. There are a number of reasons why I believe we are probably 2-3% of a swing away from victory and possibly a bit closer. One is the polling industry in Britain had a catastrophic failure in 1992 when every single one of them massively miscalled the election. What they've used since is a system of, I suppose you could call normative correction. What they do is they run a poll and then after the outcome happens, they try to work out what they got wrong and they adjust for the failure. They do that again until the next time, and by adjusting for the failure each time, their model becomes much, much better at predicting that thing. So what they become much better at is predicting UK first past the post general elections. And they are good at that. The problem is they have no form of normative correction for this kind of referendum. None at all. So they don't know how to wait. They don't know what their errors are. That's the first thing. The second thing is, if you care, and I'm sure you do, go and have a look at Scott Goes Pop. You know it? Brilliant. It's a guy called James Kelly. He's academic at Glasgow University, who's apparently John Curtis isn't the only pollster in the country. He's a polling expert, and what he does is every time every time a poll comes out on Scott Goes Pop, you'll just Google it, he just runs through each poll and tells you what's wrong. And he does it systematically in a way that you will understand. It's where I know a lot about the failures of the individual polls. But I'm going to tell you this, and I'm not going to tell you the source because I'll get the person into trouble. But suffice to say, he's a very, very knowledgeable person inside the polling world. And what they were saying was, actually, no, there's another reason why everyone's getting the polls wrong, which is they're taking at face value the reported turnout rate. So they're all expecting an 85% turnout. Now this guy says, we're not going to get an 85% turnout, we're going to get a 75% turnout. And the difference between the 85 and the 75 are uncommitted voters. And they're largely in the no side. The yes side's vote is so much more committed that, as he puts it, differential turnout could win this. So what you have is, if 75% of the population come out, all the committed no people come out. If 85% come out, you may have 10% who are kind of like, no, I'll just vote. So his argument is that his belief is that the polls are misrepresenting the impact of turnout on the overall thing. Now that's only two or three examples. You can do this poll by poll, so they weight all sorts of different things differently. They still weight working class vote lower, simply because it's less likely to turn out. And they weight older votes much higher. They weight, one of the things that he's kind of shown is that, and this is absolutely not in any way anti-English, the English people who live in Scotland tend to have come from higher economic groups. So they have a much higher weighting of the likelihood to vote, but a misrepresentative group generally in the polls. You can keep doing this. There's factor after factor. But here's the one lesson that I've done this professionally for 20 years. And the one lesson I tell everyone is, if you watch the polls, you will go mad. There is no way around it. And I've done this with clients and people that I've been advising.
Is that what happened to you?
I try not to watch polls. It's so difficult because the truth is that the closer you get towards the end of a campaign, the twitchier everybody gets. And what happens is, every time there's a good poll, it's yeah, and every time it's a bad poll, it's yeah. And the truth is that the good polls are less good than you think they are, and the bad polls are less bad than you think they are. And just try to avoid being too bipolar about it. All you can do is read what you think is happening overall. So for example, just now, what is happening overall? it doesn't look like there was a bounce for no post debate. Actually, it looks like among the likely to votes, there's been a creep up of yes. Now, if you go to undecideds or people who are unlikely to vote, that TNS, oh God, sorry, the TNS poll today, the Herald, which is one of the most biased newspapers in Scotland, which the Herald said is a big increase for no, they only got that number, and I'm not making this up, they only got that number by counting all the people in their poll who said they were definitely not going to vote. So in that poll, 10% said, I'm definitely not going to vote, and they all said, if you were going to vote, would you vote? We'd vote no. They added that in. They took all the people who said that they were unlikely to vote, and they counted them. If you only took the people who said they were certain to vote, there was a 3% increase for yes, a 3% closing of the gap. You have to be able to read polls, because they don't tell you things. Another thing that drives me mad about some pollsters is they pretend it's like physics. This is what happened. No, this is what happened with your interpretation of 1,000 people you picked and criteria that you set.
Yeah.
Not saying it's wrong and it's the best information we've got, but you've got to guess what it means. And I'll tell you that the biggest number for me, this is really important, I think, the census. In 2011, 66% of Scots now describe themselves as Scottish only. Poll yesterday, or day before, if there's a no vote, should there be another yes vote within 10 years? And 59% of people said yes. Now, both of these polls tell me something that I have believed for a long time. There are 60% of the Scottish population solidly believes that they would like Scotland to be independent. About 15% of them aren't sure if it's now, or if it's 5 years or 10 years. And in my view, winning this from here is finding that 15% saying you won't get a second chance, and if you do, you won't be voting to save the NHS, you'll be voting to rebuild an NHS.
Yes.
That 15% of people who believe that Scotland should be independent, they believe it now, they're just not sure whether they're ready. That wins or loses this, and so many of them are women and working class voters. That is who we have to talk to, and I'll say this again, if you happen to be watching Alex Salmond, that's who you have to get to in the next debate. So if you're getting prepped for the next debate, could you have someone who understands women and working class people? Just to help get the message across, because this is who we have to talk to. That 15% of lower middle class and upper working class and women who in their hearts want Scotland to be independent and aren't sure we're ready. That 50%. Sorry?
Maybe.
It might work. But the funny thing is, you know all that stuff about women don't like Alex Salmond? There's no polling evidence for that whatsoever. Women don't like Alistair Darling. You know, if you do the segmented polling, it's not true. Alex Salmond is not particularly disliked by women. And when it comes right down to it, much as I like Nicola, she ain't a debater like Alex Salmond is. An unchained Alex Salmond doing his thing.
Unchained, that's the point. Mystery to us.
I know. But that is, I don't want Alex Salmond to come out there scared. I don't want him to come out with a shh, don't scare the ladies approach. I don't know why I keep saying this. I want him to come out and just be himself and give his real heartfelt reason for why he wants this. And I think women and men will respect that alike. And that will be
take
important. But the debate isn't going to matter anyway. This is going to be won on the ground. That's where this will be won or lost. On the ground, in the workplaces, among your friends and families, that's where this wins. I don't worry about the debate. It's up to us. The debate can do harm, but I don't think it'll win it. It's up to us. Oh, well, those of us, I keep forgetting this is an undecided audience. It's up to us who believe this to make sure this happens. And God, don't blame anybody else.
I said that would be the last question because these guys need to actually get back to their own lives as well. Can I just give you some good news on the polling front? Because the yes group locally in Kirkintilloch, Lenzie, the villages has been out constantly. We've got some of the highest canvas returns across any region in Scotland. And I can absolutely assure you, we do not pick who we go out and canvas. We chap on every door, regardless of who's in that property. And we're finding that yes is ahead of no in this constituency. In each of the wards that we look after, yes is ahead of no, and in some cases quite substantially ahead of no. Before we finish tonight, I've got one thing I would like to do to make this point to the audience before you leave. I'd like all the guys in the room who are under 40 to stand up, if you would. And I want everybody else to look at them.
because one in four of these guys will never collect a pension from the UK government. One in four. That's the reality in this constituency. That's the reality across the centre of Scotland, and it's most certainly the reality in parts of Glasgow where the number goes up to one in three.
Yeah.
So I want you to look at these guys, and when you go into that polling booth, I want you to think of which one you think shouldn't collect
his
their pension.
His girlfriend seems to think it's him.
That's what you're voting for. You're not voting on Alex Salmond, you're not even voting on the pound. You're not voting on whether or not people like England or like Westminster or anything else. These are the people who are going to be affected by this vote. And I want you to think about them when you go into the ballot box. And thanks to the guys for standing up. And if you could give a round of applause to us. Because
if there's anyone who's not signed the Declaration for Independence yet, there are seats at the bottom if you would like to sign it before that is where you would like to go. To those who came tonight, the opportunity there if you'd like. Thanks again.
There are canvassing cards at the back here, if you'd like to tell us whether or not you're yes or undecided, they're at the table at the back. Claire's giving you out.
I think I've always noticed that you see.